start, so here are some church-appropriate dance moves you can do whenever the spirit moves you. So get on up and let's sweat to some scriptures. Or maybe not. Or just here we go. One, two, three, four. Shirts on the face. See it on the face. Yeah. Bring it together. Here we go. Let it go. You take this down. You let it go. You're unhindered by armor. Let that elbow sway. Elbow. One of my personal favorites. Resurrection. You gotta get down to get back. Keep working it, guys. Keep working it. Don't grab it. I'm doing it. Now keep it a little tight.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. John's
Stuckenfield Online. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to St John's Church, Stuckenfield Online. It's really great to have you with us. This morning, you have two for the price of one. The first part of this morning is designed for families and kids, and there is a cast of millions, well, I mean, certainly a few, but they're going to be helping us worship God together on this Sunday morning. And then, after the notices, we're going to transition into something much more specifically geared to grown-ups. Stuart's going to give us a word. We're going to have some worship as well. And if families, perhaps young children, would like to leave us at that point, although if you want to keep on watching, it would be great to still have you with us. There's going to be competitions and all sorts of activities over the next few minutes together. But before we do anything, I'm going to pray and ask God's blessing upon this time. So let's pray wherever we are, whatever we're doing right now. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you're here. You promise that by your Spirit, that wherever two or three gather in your name, then you're going to be right in the midst of them. And I pray that as we come together, you may give us a sense of your joy and your resurrection life, that we may worship you and that you may speak to us. Amen. Now, obviously, it's still Easter. Easter carries on for many, many weeks. And so we're going to begin with those Easter acclamations. And I will say some words, and if you respond as well. The words are my words, hallelujah, Christ is risen, and you respond, he is risen indeed, hallelujah. So let's stand up. Let's get ready for this. I will say, hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let's do it again a bit louder. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Finally, hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. We're going to stand and we're going to sing our first hymn, which is Thine Be the Glory. Thank you.
Together. The words will appear on the screen in a moment, and these are words which give a sense of shape and content and direction to all the things we're going to be doing over these minutes spent together. Let's say these words together, saying, "We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God." When we come to worship God, every single one of us comes in need of his forgiveness. And so we're going to use that prayer of confession now. It's an opportunity to be honest before God as we seek afresh his forgiveness, which is made available to us through faith in Christ. Jesus says, "Repent, turn, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and in faith. And so we say together, "Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen." May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, last week we started looking at that memory verse, John chapter verse. Can anyone remember it? John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." John chapter 14, verse 6. Now, there is a song which goes with it. It's quite an old song. A few of us remember it from our childhood. So let's give it a go together, and it will certainly help us remember the first part of that verse, John 14, verse 6. And the song goes like this. "I am the way, the truth, and the life," that's what Jesus said. "I am the way, the truth, and the life," that's what Jesus said. "Without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. Without the life, there is no living. I am the way, the truth, and the life," that's what Jesus said. So let's just remind ourselves of that verse, John 14, verse 6. Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Just encourage you to keep on learning that memory verse. Now we're going to go over to Denise Conley, who has an Easter quiz for us.
Morning, everyone. Hope you're all okay. I thought this morning, when we got together, that we could do a bit of exercise. But don't worry, we're only going to exercise your competitiveness, because I know there's a lot of you out there like me that are a fan of a quiz. So I've got a quiz here for you this morning based on the events of Easter Sunday. So if you get yourself a pen and a paper, and if you've got your Bibles out, brilliant. John chapter 20 will be helpful for you if you need it. And it'll save us all using Google. I don't mind how you play. You can play as an individual, you can play as teams in your house, or you can play as a whole household. And this is how it's going to work. There are 7 questions, and each question has an A, a B, or a C answer. Write your answer on the piece of paper. Don't put your answers in the comment box below in the live feed. At the end of the quiz, my email address will appear at the bottom, and the winner will be the first correct answer in my email box after the service. Don't send it before the service because that won't count, but after the service. I'll give a shout out to the winner on the St. John's Facebook page and on Google Groups. And if I can, following the social distance rule, I'll get a prize to you. So if you're ready, here we go. Question 1. On Easter Sunday, what time of day did the women go to the tomb? Was it A, late Sunday evening, B, Sunday afternoon, or C, early Sunday morning? On Easter Sunday, what time of day did the women go to the tomb? Question 2. Who did Mary think the risen Jesus was? Was it A, a gardener, B, a guard, or C, one of the disciples? Who did Mary think the risen Jesus was? Question 3. Who did Mary run to tell the news that she had seen the risen Lord? Was it A, the Pharisees, B, the disciples, or C, the Roman guards? Who did Mary run to tell the news that she had seen the risen Lord? Question 4. Why were the disciples meeting behind locked doors? Was it A, because it was the law, B, because they were afraid, or C, because they'd lost the door key? Why were the disciples meeting behind locked doors? Question 5. What did Jesus say to the disciples when he appeared to them? Was it A, peace be with you, B, I told you I'd be back, or C, why are you afraid? What did Jesus say to the disciples when he appeared to them? Question 6. What did the risen Jesus show to the disciples? Was it A, the cloth he had been wrapped in? Was it B, the wounds on his hands and feet? Or was it C, the sign that had been hung on the cross? What did the risen Jesus show to the disciples? And finally, question 7. Which disciple was not with the others when Jesus appeared to them? Was it A, Peter, B, John, or C, Thomas? Which disciple was not with the others when Jesus appeared to them? Okay, that's the end of the quiz. So now my email address should be here at the bottom. And like I said, the winners will be the first one in my inbox after the end of the service. So enjoy. See you soon. Bye.
Thanks, Denise, for that. We're now going to dust down an old song and bring it out of retirement. We haven't done this for years and years and years. An old holiday club song. I once was frightened of spiders. Now, I know that we've got that song out and about this week. And I think that Clara and Harry are watching right now. Clara and Harry, give me a wave. Can you wave now at the screen? I think I can just about see you there. Yep, that's great. Now, if you've been learning this, I want you to sing it out really loud. If you're not quite sure, don't worry, sing along. But for everybody, it's a song actually, which kind of fits in with what Stuart's going to be sharing with us in a few minutes' time. Let's give it a go. Now, just before we do that, I know that over the past 24 hours, a number of people have posted things they are frightened of on social media. So just a quick shout out to various people here. Barbara Cook, fearful of COVID-19. I think we can all agree with that one. Helena, spiders. James, Alex and Toby. James is frightened of clowns. That's another recurring theme. Alex, that their pet dog Sadie was would be killed, and Toby agreed with Alex. Liz Bird, indoor spiders and dogs anywhere. But it has to be said, actually, that there is one person in the church centre. He's a go-to guy. And whenever anyone finds a spider, they go to this person and ask them to take it out of the building, Liz. Alan, rats in large numbers. Yes, I can identify with that. Sue Mason, flying. Yes, we've heard some funny stories there. John Lee, clowns are scary. Again, that's quite familiar. Margaret Dimelow, mice are so small. Sarah Walker, vultures. Jeff, people in isolation. That's a great fear many people have at the moment. Peter Noble, Himalayan spiders. And he says, you need to ask Mike Redfern on that one. So I think we can all do that after the service. Pauline Flint, face masks. Don't go to hospital at this time. Dawn Turner, again, spiders. Debbie Seal, not being accepted and being rejected. I think that's a universal fear. We all are frightened of that. As well as mice, spiders, heights, vultures, face masks, clowns, rats and stings. And then finally, David Carter. The thing he is most frightened of is, yes, Phil Jones, in common with many Manchester United supporters. That's a good example there. Phil Jones is most frightened of the ball, and you can see that in his face. Okay, are we ready for this song? I once was frightened of spiders and Phil Jones.
I once was frightened of spiders. I once was frightened of the dark. I once was frightened by many, many things, especially things that bark.
Woo, woo.
But now I'm asking Jesus to help these fears to go. 'Cause I don't want them to be part of me. No, 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 no. I once was frightened of thunder and frightened of lightning too. I once was frightened by many, many things, with a crash and bang and blue. But now I'm asking Jesus to help these fears to go. 'Cause I don't want them to be part of me. No, no.
Jesus said when we're frightened of things, anxious of things, we can tell him. He encourages us to tell him. And the promise is that when we do that, he will give us his peace. So we've got to be honest, tell others, tell Jesus what those fears are. Ask him to fill you with his peace. Okay, Liz especially, out loud.
I once was frightened of spiders. I once was frightened of the dark. I once was frightened by many, many things, especially things that bark.
Woo, woo.
But now I'm asking Jesus to help these fears to go. 'Cause I don't want them to be part of me. No, no.
We're now going to go over to Kerry, who's got a reading for us from God's Word.
Everyone, I do hope every one of you is okay. Today's reading, it comes from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he had said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nails marked in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked. Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Kerry, for that. We're now going to have some prayers. Ben, Hannah, and Lydia are going to help us pray with the aid of some Duplo figures. And if anyone can spot the fat controller in this next segment.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for all the people who are working hard to look after us at this difficult time. We especially thank you for
our firefighters and emergency service workers who are working hard to keep us all safe.
For postmen and women who are delivering us packages and parcels.
What's this? Thank you, God, for all the shopkeepers who are making sure that we can buy all the food and other things that we need.
And for doctors and nurses who are looking after the people who aren't feeling very well.
Thank you, God, for all our train and bus drivers who are making sure that we can get to places safely when we need to.
And for the people who are looking after the roads and railways at the same time.
Thank you, God, for teachers who are making sure that children can learn even when schools are closed.
And we thank you for our families as well who look after us during difficult times. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Ben. Thanks, Hannah. And thanks, Lydia. Now, I know that this is a little bit of an internet sensation, really. People are kind of wondering, where is Stuart going to speak from this week? We have had a tour, in many ways, of his house and his garden. So where is he going to take us today? Over to Stuart.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Under the Stairs cupboard. We've done some talks from some pretty strange places over the past week or so, and perhaps this is the strangest. What do we do in these places? Well, this is where we hide things that are important, but we don't want people to see. So here we have our boiler that provides our heating and hot water to the house, but it's pretty ugly and it's good to hide it away under the stairs cupboard. Here's our alarm system that protects our house. And again, it's important, but it's hidden away under here because it's not very attractive to look at, really, is it? Down here is our electric fuse box that provides the electricity for the house. Wow, that's important, isn't it? But we don't really want to see the fuse box. Behind me there is the ironing board. Here is our iron, our clothes airers, things that are useful, but we don't really want to see them, do we? And behind me is our shoe rack, which contains all those shoes that we wear for walking and running and everyday use. They're tucked away here, where they're not seen. They are hidden from view. We all have a place like this, don't we? A place where we keep important things that we don't really want people to see. The other thing about these kind of places is that they can be a place of hiding for us too. When I was a child and we used to play hide and seek, the place I used to like to hide was the under the stairs cupboard in my parents' home. As a small child, it felt a place of security, a place of being covered, a place where no one could find me. It's interesting, isn't it, that hide and seek is one of the first games that children learn to play. And even teenagers love a good game of hide and seek, don't they? Our fusion groups certainly do. Right back at the beginning of humanity, when the relationship between God and human beings was broken by Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve's first response was to hide. To hide away where they hoped God wouldn't find them. But God came seeking for them. He came seeking for them so he could demonstrate his grace towards them. God found them in their hiding place. In John chapter 20, we find the disciples in a hiding place. In fact, it even uses the word locked. They were locked away. They were in lockdown, just like we're in lockdown today. Verse 19 tells us that the doors were locked for fear of the Jews. Verse 26 tells us that the doors were locked, and behind those locked doors was Thomas with all his doubts. And yet Jesus appears to them in their place of hiding. Jesus comes to them in their place of lockdown. And he comes to move them from fear to faith. And in order to do that, he speaks some words to them. Twice they're recorded for us in this passage. Three times, actually. And those words are, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." They needed peace to calm their fears. And isn't that true for many of us today? In our fears, in our anxieties, we need God's peace. But what does that mean? How can Jesus bring us peace in our hiding place, in our lockdown, in our fears this morning? When Jesus says, "Peace I give to you," he's not talking about a warm, gooey feeling. He's not talking about putting a comfort blanket over us so that we can hide. He's speaking about something much more important than that. The word peace is the Jewish idea of shalom. When you go into a Jewish house, you will often see that phrase over the door as you enter the home. Shalom, peace. But that word means more than just a nice emotional warm feeling. It means more than just words. The phrase shalom means wholeness, completeness, being in a place of blessing from God, being in the place where our lives are fulfilled in relation to God's purposes, being in a place where we're experiencing God's promises at work in our lives, being in that place where we are being all that we were created to be. This is the peace that Jesus brings to the disciples. And it is a life-transforming peace. It moves them from fear to faith. And Jesus wants us to know this life-transforming peace this morning that will move us from fear to faith. Can he bring it to us today? Can he bring it to us in our hiding place? Can he bring it to us in our place of lockdown? I believe he can. Remember in John's Gospel, right at the beginning, we thought about those words, that Jesus is the Word became flesh, who lived for a while among us. Jesus became flesh. That is, he knows what it's like to deal with fears. As he wrestled in prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane just hours before his death, he knew what it was like to face the fear of death and to bring it to his Father. And he can relate to our fears this morning. He knows what we are going through. But he also not only comes in flesh, he comes as the Word in flesh. Jesus didn't stop being God in the Garden of Gethsemane. He understood what it is to be human, but he didn't stop being God. And it is this unique identity of Jesus that enables him to come into our fears and to draw us by faith into his peace. Jesus stood before those disciples in those locked rooms as the resurrected Lord. We've been thinking about Jesus in John's Gospel being someone greater who's come to do something bigger. And here we have it again in chapter 20. He is someone greater. He is the God-man who knows our fears, who confronts our fears, who has overcome our fears. But he comes as also the one who has come to do something bigger. He has dealt with the biggest fear that faces humanity, the fear of death. And he has conquered that fear, and he's showing the disciples that he's done that now through his resurrection and through his appearance to them. And he's saying to us when he says, "Peace be with you," what he's saying is, see all your fears through me. Don't see them in your circumstances. See all your fears through me. He can deal with our fears. Jesus is bigger than our fears and our anxieties and our worries. Jesus is bigger than coronavirus. And when we see our lives through him as the resurrected Lord, then Jesus comes to us and moves us from fear to faith. Wherever our hiding place is this morning, wherever our place of lockdown is this morning, Jesus stands in front of us and invites us to receive his peace. Peace that is not found in circumstances, but is found in relationship, our relationship with him. And that is what Jesus invites us to receive today. So in your hiding place, in your place of lockdown, may Jesus stand before you this morning. And may you open your life to receive him in faith. And as you do that, may you know what it means to own Jesus as Lord, the risen Lord, who can conquer your fears and bring you into a place of faith in him and in his word. If you'd like to explore these ideas a little bit more, then I'm going to be doing a longer, more detailed talk for adults at the end of our morning together. Stick around and have a listen to that. But if not, my prayer is that you might experience Jesus this morning moving you from fear to faith. Enjoy the rest of the service and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks, Stuart, for that. We're going to have some notices now. It's an opportunity just to think a little bit about what has happened. We've enjoyed spring harvest and we're looking at some events coming up this week. Beforehand, just to remember, 1, 2, 3. One, every one day, contact two people and pray for three. Every one day, contact two people and pray for three. Now, I have seen this video, which has come up many, many times on various social media platforms, and it just encourages us to keep in touch with people. And I loved it so much, I thought I would share it with you right now.
Well, I was wondering what to do when my thoughts quickly turned to you. Just because you are my friend and I just need a reason to reach out. But there's nothing to talk about. It's not New Year's, you're not sick, or your birthday, Grandma's Day. Nothing to congratulate.
Opportunity to think a little bit about what people are doing around the world. Ranjan and Carmen, leading one of the Vineyard Bangalore churches, they've been involved with taking food, vital supplies out to various villages surrounding Bangalore. The shutdown in India is very draconian, and a lot of people, especially poor people, have very little access to food and supplies. So we'll show some pictures now of what they're doing in Bangalore.
Hi, this is Rajan from Bangalore, India. It's 32 degrees out here right now, and I'm just out to buy some essential supplies for the family. Hope you are all well during this COVID-19 crisis. We are doing great. In some ways, I think UK has been hit quite severely, and our prayers are with you. But it's great to be as a family together under one roof during this time. Theo arrived from the boarding school just a few hours before the lockdown started, and I arrived a little after that, just a few hours before the curfew, from a mission trip to Bihar with some of the guys in the church. It was quite a phenomenal trip. Thanks for being mindful of us during this time of great testing. Now, one thing is the Lord stressed of this lockdown was having a perspective, keeping in line with the kingdom values and my faith and the belief. And there are several passages, but I don't want to get into all of that. So when this opportunity to take the essential supplies presented itself to us, my initial reaction was, no way, you know, I don't know how long this is going to last, and the supplies that which we have, we need, because we don't know when it's going to end. And then I thought, well, there are also so many other people who are going to be doing this during this time. And what will I make a difference in this? So there were so many excuses not to do it. But then I had to be reminded of what the Lord had been speaking to me even before this whole thing started. And at the outset of this crisis, you know, there were a lot of talks about people hoarding, and that was the news headlines everywhere. You know, no toilet paper, no this, no that, etc. But slowly, we are also hearing many people who are coming out of their comfort zone to help those who are less privileged. And I thank God for that perspective, which enables us to do that and make a difference in a small way we could. The more I'm out there with these essential supplies to give to the people, the more I see the need. And I'm so glad I said yes to that and to make a difference in so many people's lives. And thank you for your partnership. Thanks for your prayers. And I think it's us doing together for the kingdom. Stay blessed, stay safe, and love from our family to yours. Bye.
This week, on Wednesday, we're going to meet together and we're going to have another worship central. We're going to sing, we're going to worship, we're going to pray, and we have another really great talk from Tim Keller. I know that many people have enjoyed listening and watching Tim Keller over the past few weeks, and that's not going to be an exception this Wednesday. So we want to encourage everyone to be there. We're going to start at 7 o'clock. 7 o'clock, Worship Central on Wednesday. We're going to end this part of the service again with another classic children's song. Our God is a great big God. And I want to thank you for Evie and Izzy, who are going to lead us in worship. So thanks to the Sayer family. Let's stand and we'll give this song a go.
One.
Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hand. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. He holds us in His hand. He's higher than the skyscraper. Deeper than the submarine. He's wider than the universe and beyond my wildest dreams. And He's known me and He's loved me since before the world began. How wonderful to be a part of God's amazing plan. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. He holds us in His hand. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. He holds us in His hand. He's higher than the skyscraper, deeper than the submarine. He's wider than the universe and beyond my wildest dreams. And He's known me and He's loved me since before the world began. How wonderful to be a part of God's amazing plan.
I hope you're all doing the actions at home.
Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hand. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hand. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. He holds us in His hands. He holds us in His hands.
Quietly.
He holds us.
Shout it out! And He holds us!
citizens!
Well, we're going to bring this time to a close right now. I'm going to say a prayer of blessing. Let's pray. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and upon all whom we love, now and forever. Amen. Okay, now, we're going to transition into a different part of the service right now. Just to give us a few minutes, we're going to play a video which has made quite an impact on many people. We used it on Good Friday. What's so good about Friday? So we're going to use this, then we're going to worship. I'm going to teach. Well, it's a new song to us. It's been around for a number of years. I think some people will know. It's a wonderful song, which is very relevant to our time and our season. And then Stuart will bring us God's word this morning.
Good Friday. How can one describe such a day? The wrongdoing of all humanity, putting to an end an innocent man, the Son of God. This is the story of Jesus' death by way of a cross, all in one moment bringing death to the bright light of our future. He never stopped loving us, and yet this is the incredible part of it. Our sin stopped his heart. Our sin drove the nails firmly in the hands of God. All along, these were the plans. We told ourselves that we were in control, and this was deemed sufficient for all of us. The brutal beating, the inhuman flogging, the naked humiliation. Heaven watched and saw it all. Our rebellion, our guilt, our shame, erasing the very notion of reconciling us with God. Our sin and our debt, overcoming Jesus. Here is our King, obliterated. The enemy laughing, his plans unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of freedom rising. Now God's people are utterly broken. Behold the chains of mortality. Yes, this is what is true. We had heard the stories of old. The lost are found, the blind can see, the weak are made strong. But now we are witnesses to this reality. God is dead. We'd almost believed there is a way of redemption. There is a life of fulfillment. There is a peace beyond understanding. Now we know better. For us, we can say that God is encapsulated in this one realization. The single greatest sacrifice in human history is finished. How clearly we can see it. So what's so good about Good Friday? Just one thing, that the blood of Jesus can reverse the curse of sin and raise the dead to life. How clearly we can see it is finished. The single greatest sacrifice in human history encapsulated in this one realization. We can say that God is for us. Now we know better. There is a peace beyond understanding. There is a life of fulfillment. There is a way of redemption. We'd almost believed God is dead, but now we are witnesses to this reality. The weak are made strong. The blind can see. The lost are found. We had heard the stories of old. Yes, this is what is true. The chains of mortality utterly broken. Behold, freedom rising. Now God's people are unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of the enemy laughing. His plans obliterated. Here is our King, Jesus, overcoming our sin and our debt, reconciling us with God, erasing the very notion of our rebellion. the wrongdoing of all humanity. How can one describe such a day? Good Friday.
Lord Jesus, we pray that as we come before you now, we may know you, the way maker. Spirit, we invite you now into our circumstances, into our homes, into our fears, into our questions. Come now.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lights around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lights around. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You're gonna stop
You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Sing it out.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Jesus, I thank you that your promises are sure, and I thank you that even in this time we have a unique opportunity to prove that your words are true, your love is steadfast, your promises will never fail. And so, Lord, as Stuart opens your word, I pray that you may come and speak to us in your power, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning, everyone. Thank you for rejoining us as we look again at John chapter 20, as we explore together how this fullness of life that John speaks about can help us to deal with our fears at this time and can be a real experience for us. Let me just refresh your memories by reading part of the passage that we read earlier on in our main service. I'm just going to focus on verses 19 through to 23 in John 20. So let me read those words for you first of all. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." This is the word of the Lord. As we come to this closing section of John's Gospel, we come to the climax of John's purpose in writing this Gospel. As we read earlier on at the end of the passage, John writes this biography for a very specific purpose, that his readers might believe in Jesus as the Christ, the Son of God, and that through believing they may have life in his name. Throughout his biography, John has recorded for us seven signs and seven I am sayings. And their purpose was that his readers may come to believe who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of God, and as a result of that belief, they may receive the life in his name that he came to bring. The seven I am sayings tell us who God is, that Jesus is God in human form. The seven signs point us to what he came to do, to bring us the life that only Jesus can bring. And now in this section, as John records these resurrection appearances of Jesus, we see this being worked out in the lives of these first witnesses. He tells us how the women witnessed the resurrection, with a particular focus on Mary Magdalene, as you might expect, as she is a central character in John's Gospel. He tells us about a couple of appearances to the disciple group, but again, with a particular focus on two of them, Thomas confronted with his doubts and Peter confronted with his denial. We'll look at Thomas on Wednesday evening in our Worship Central gathering. We'll look at Peter next Sunday in our morning gathering. For this morning, I'm just going to focus on this appearance that John records for us in chapter 20 to the group of disciples. One of the greatest pieces of evidence for the resurrection is the incredible change that took place in the lives of those who encountered the risen Jesus. Nor is that more true than these disciples. Here they are, cowering in fear in a locked room. And yet within days they had become powerful witnesses to the reality of who Jesus is and his work in their lives, to such an extent that they were even willing to die for it. Can Jesus have the same impact in our lives today? As we are surrounded by our fears at this time, can Jesus step into the locked room of our lives and transform us in such a way that we too become convinced followers of Jesus, who are willing to worship him and to serve him as our risen Lord? As John has shown us throughout his gospel, this is both a theological issue and a practical issue. It's about what we believe and it's about how we live. In this section, in verses 19 to 23, John addresses this through the experience of the disciples' fear. Do they believe that Jesus can overcome their fears? And are they willing to let him do that in a practical way? And this seems such a relevant question for us at this time. Can Jesus come into our lockdown? Can Jesus come into our fears? Can Jesus transform our lives so that we can know this life to the full that he wants to bring us? Even when so many of us have experienced people and things we cherish being taken away from us, can we still experience the peace of God and the transforming power of his Spirit in these days? Fear is something that we all experience in different ways. Some of us are afraid of heights. Some of us are afraid of open spaces. Some of us are afraid of closed spaces. Some of us are afraid of dogs and spiders, as we were reminded in the children's song earlier on. Some of us are afraid of the dark. Some of us are afraid of loud noises. We all have things which cause us fear, and our response to those fears is usually avoidance, although sometimes psychologists tell us confrontation might be better. But we will only make the effort to try and overcome those fears
if we feel they restrict our lives. To use the phrase here, when our fear locks us up, when our fear restricts our movements, it's only then that we are often motivated to do something about it. In this incident, Jesus confronts these men in their fear, not bullying them into action, but gently persuading them that he's offering them the opportunity to overcome their fear and to step out of this locked room that is holding them prisoner. How does he do that for these disciples? How can he do that for us this morning? Well, let's explore this passage and find some answers. Firstly, Jesus can do it by conquering the ultimate fear. The ultimate fear for most people is death. And that's very real for many people at the moment. And the most obvious effect of Jesus coming and standing among these fearful men is that they realise that the ultimate fear has been overcome. As the disciples are huddled in this small secret room, their greatest fear for them was that for them too death was imminent. John tells us in verse 19 that the reason they were fearful was they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. They were afraid that that group who had conspired to bring about Jesus' death would now come after them and bring about their death. Their fear wasn't just that their lives would be uncomfortable, or that they might be harmed, or that they would lose something important. It was more serious than that. Their friendship with Jesus made them marked men. They were facing death too. Peter had already had a narrow escape when his swearing and cursing got him off the hook of physical death. Be under no illusions. These men were facing the ultimate fear. They had seen what had happened to Jesus. Now they feared that this would happen to them. And this passage provides a number of phrases which were powerful witnesses to what is taking place here. This is no ghost story. This is no hallucination or illusion. This is real. Verse 20, he showed them his hands and his side. Verse 22, he breathed on them. Verse 27, with Thomas, he invited him to touch him. Throughout the passage, Jesus speaks clearly to them. When John says, the word became flesh and lived for a while among us, well, here we have it. Here is Jesus in the flesh, showing them his hands and sides, breathing on them, inviting them to touch him, speaking to them. This is a real man. This is no ghost. This is the risen Jesus. This is the one who a few days earlier had been subjected to a brutal beating, who had died in the searing sun on a Roman cross. Yet now he stands right in front of them. They see him, they hear him, they touch him. The inescapable conclusion is that Jesus has overcome the ultimate fear, death itself. And it is this fact that gives Jesus the power to deal with our fears. Physical death is still a reality. Grieving over a lost one is still a painful reality. But Jesus has conquered the ultimate effect of this reality. The sting is drawn. Its power is gone. And this means that he's able to help us to deal with our fears. He is the someone greater who alone could conquer death. And now he gives us the opportunity to experience something bigger through his resurrection. The banishing of fear, the ultimate fear, through the confidence in his resurrection. So as Jesus comes here this morning, as he stands in front of us, he calls us to experience that reality of him being the one who has conquered the ultimate fear, and to see our fears through that lens. The second way he invites us to overcome our fears is by focusing on a challenge. Overcoming our fears is very practical. And as part of Jesus' dealing with these men, he does something very interesting. He throws down a challenge to them. You see, in this situation, he has to get them out of their locked room. While they remain there, locked in their fears, they're not going to be able to be the people he wants them to be and do what he wants them to do. So he has to get them out. And he does this by giving them a challenge. A challenge which can only be fulfilled by them moving on from their fear and moving out in his power. The challenge for them is not just to pray, but to go. Now, of course, this is difficult for us at this time. For many of us, we are rediscovering what it means to pray, and that's a wonderful thing. In the absence of our ability to physically go, then to pray is important. However, there are still ways in which we can respond to the challenge of going. The wonders of modern technology that enable me to bring this message to you this morning are there for us. Isn't it incredible how we're discovering how this crisis, terrible though it is actually enabling us to go with the message of the gospel in a way that we have failed to do in the past. More and more people are being reached. We are going, albeit in a very different way. Maybe it seems harsh for Jesus to bring a challenge to us when we're in such a crisis, as for those disciples. We could excuse them. We could say, well, they've been through a traumatic experience. Their lives were under threat. Surely their personal safety should be the paramount thing. But no, for Jesus, the only way for them to overcome their fear is to get involved again in the real world, to deal with the real issues, to go. Fear causes us to be inward looking. In fact, many of our fears have their origins in our own minds rather than the world outside. So part of our solution to overcoming our fears is to get our minds focused on the things of God that will begin to move us out of our locked room of fear. There's a story of a son lying in bed on a Sunday morning. His mother knocks on the door and says, "Get up, it's time to go to church." The son replies, "I'm not going to church this morning." A few minutes later, his mother tries again. She knocks on the door. "Come on, it's time to go to church." The son replies, "I'm not going to church this morning." A third time, the mother, even more frantically, knocks on the door. "Come on, you'll be late. It's time to go to church." "No," says the son, "I'm not going to church this morning." The mother persists. "Give me two good reasons why you shouldn't go to church this morning." The muffled reply comes, "One, they don't like me. Two, I don't like them." The son continues, "You give me two good reasons why I should go to church this morning." The mother replies, "One, you're 40 years old. Two, you're the vicar." Sometimes it's easier to stay than to go. And often it's our thoughts that dictate us. our thoughts about ourselves, about what people think about us, that causes us to stay rather than go. Jesus calls us not to move out, not on the basis of what we think about ourselves and what others might think of us. Jesus calls us to move out on the basis of what God thinks about us and what God has done for us. On who God is and what he's come to do. John reminds us, as he did in chapter 1, that Jesus is the Word become flesh, coming into the world. John reminds us in that famous verse in chapter 3, verse 16, that God so loved the world that he sent, he gave his one and only Son. Jesus reminds us in this passage that we need to receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus has promised his presence with us. And as he sends us, so he sends his Spirit to enable us, to equip us for going out, for dealing with our fears. We forgive because God first forgave us. We go not on our own basis, not in our own fears, but in the knowledge of who Jesus is and what he has done. There's no question that God is putting us in a really challenging situation at the moment. And many are fearful about that, about what that might mean for us. But maybe the only way we can ultimately deal with these fears is to remember that we face them and we step out against them in the power that raised Jesus from the dead. And that event proves that he is someone greater. And to know that God's plans and purposes for us remain the same reminds us that God in Jesus has come to do something bigger than we can imagine at this time. And I believe God is already doing that. But he's going to do it even more in the days that lie ahead. But we need to come to him to experience his resurrection power at work in us and the challenge of going into the world that he lays before us. The final way this passage points us to overcoming our fears is by reminding us of our freedom. Freedom's a wonderful thing. People will go to extraordinary lengths, do extraordinary things to experience freedom. To be held captive is one of the worst forms of punishment because you lose your freedom. This is what happened to the disciples. They were holding themselves captive by their own fears. We can be totally free physically, but imprisoned in our minds. We can be imprisoned physically, but totally free in our minds. And that's the struggle for many of us at this time, isn't it? When we feel imprisoned by our isolation, by our shielding, how can we experience the freedom that comes from our minds? One of the memory verses I learnt in my younger days is very relevant here. 2 Corinthians 10 verse 5. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. Isn't that a great verse to memorise and to hold on to at this time? We take captive every thought. And what do we do with it? We enable it to make us obedient to Christ. Our freedom is not found in being able to go out and do when we like and do whatever we like. Our freedom as Christians is not found in our circumstances. It's found in a relationship, our relationship with Christ. And so even though we might feel imprisoned at this time, we might feel we're held captive, what God encourages us to do is, even though we are limited in what we can do physically, to make sure that in our minds we feed on God's word. We let his truth sink in. We take our thoughts and we make them obedient to Christ. We live according to what God is saying to us, not according to what we are saying to ourselves or the world is saying to us. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. That's freedom. That's real freedom. That's true freedom. That's the freedom that God brings us in Jesus Christ. We are not prisoners today. We may feel like it, but the reality is we are not prisoners today. Christ has set us free from sin to live in the freedom of his Spirit. We are not isolated today, because the great promise that keeps repeating itself throughout the Bible is that he is always with us, even to the end of this age. We may feel weak and vulnerable today, but remember, God has said that when we are weak, in actual fact, it's then that we are strong. Because it's in our weakness we become most dependent upon God. And it's then that we know his promise, that in our weakness, his strength is made perfect. True story about an Arab chief who tells the story of a spy who was captured and then sentenced to death by a Persian army general. This general had the strange custom of giving condemned criminals a choice. That as they were led out to be executed, they had a choice. Either they could face the firing squad, or they could go through a big black door. As the moment for execution drew near, the spy was brought to the general, who asked him the question, "So what will it be, the firing squad or the big black door?" The spy hesitated for a long time. It was a difficult decision, but he chose the firing squad. Moments later, shots rang out, confirming his execution. The general turned to his aide and said, "They always prefer the known way to the unknown. It is characteristic of people to be afraid of the undefined. Yet we gave him a choice." The aide said, "What lies beyond the big black door?" The general replied, "Freedom. But I've only known a few brave enough to take it." Jesus was brave enough to confront the big black door of death. Jesus was obedient enough and brave enough to walk through it. As he hung on the cross, people thought they had taken his freedom away from him once and for all. They had him where they wanted him. But his resurrection showed that for Jesus, death was the door to true freedom. And now he demonstrates that freedom by appearing before the disciples in a room where they were hiding behind a locked door. He invites them to be brave enough to see their fears through the lens of the resurrection. He invites them to be brave enough to step through the door that leads to freedom. Out into a world with, yes, challenges, but where they can live their lives on the basis of the freedom of life that Christ gave them by rising from the dead. This is the path to the peace that Jesus offers them. Peace is not some nice, warm comfort blanket. The word peace, shalom, was a common greeting, but it wasn't just words. It was more than a well-meaning phrase. It was more than a nice feeling. The phrase had deep and profound meaning. It meant wholeness, completeness. It meant spiritual blessing from God. It meant the complete fulfillment of life as a child of God. And it's a promise that we can receive this life to the full that John says Jesus has come to bring. All the potential of our lives here on earth will at last be released through God's work in our lives. And through that, we will become the people he intended us to be eternally. And that can happen for us today. We can receive this peace to counter our fears today. We can receive this peace that releases us from captivity into freedom. We may suffer for the moment a short period of physical containment, but that doesn't deny us the peace and the freedom that Jesus brings to us today. Do you believe this Jesus is someone greater? Do you believe this Jesus is God's Son, come to forgive us, to save us, to give us new life? Do you believe this Jesus can do something bigger for you today? Do you believe Jesus can cast out your fears, open the door of your locked life, and bring to you his love and his life so that you may know this fullness of life that John's gospel is all about, that John promises Jesus comes to bring? Let's pause for a moment and pray, shall we? Lord Jesus, we worship you this morning. We worship you as the resurrected Lord. We worship you as the one who became flesh and lived for a while among us. We worship you as the ascended God. And Lord, we lay our lives before you in these moments. You know our circumstances, Lord, because you've been here. You know our fears, Lord, because you've known them. You know our hopes, Lord. And we pray that you will meet with us today in such a way that you will unlock the door of our hearts and allow you to enter in. That you will unlock the door of our minds so that our minds might be transformed by your truth. You will unlock the door of all of our lives that we might find in you everything we need and more. So Lord, come to us with your peace this morning, we pray. Fill us with your Holy Spirit and send us out, whatever that means at this time, that we might serve you in all that we say and do. We give our lives to you this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. May you experience the peace of God in your life today.
We're going to bring our time together to an end now as we sing Living Hope.
Darkness, your loving kindness shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory.
Able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. Don't forget, see you on Wednesday, Worship Central at 7 o'clock.